I hope that you have done your homework and you have watched the Sully movie.
Oh yeah, Mamesh.
So tell me, how was it?
It was an emergency landing because of a bird strike in the dual engine failure. So I saw that cabin, they say that head down, knees have to be straight so that they will not get hurt as much as they can possible. And after the crash landing, there will be investigation will be going on for what the purpose and the cause of that. That's it. Is it okay?
Tell me, how was this the emergency? How did that occur?
It was a bird strike.
It was a bird strike. Okay, yeah. And were there any injuries? Any casualties?
No, not a single person in the aircraft.
And where did this happen?
In New York.
Where did this happen?
Hello?
Yes, yes. Can you hear my voice?
Oh, yeah, ma'am. New York, ma'am.
New York. Okay. And the Hudson River, right?
Okay.
Now, so this was the movie about. I wanted you to see that how the emergency occurred. Emergency can occur anytime. Right after takeoff, the bird strike was, it happened, and both the engines failed. First, it started with the first engine, then the other engine also got fire, so both engines failed. And how the crew, the flight crew as well as the cabin crew, they were so
giving instructions about the ASS.
Yes.
How to handle the situation. Yes.
Yes. And that's how they carried the emergency or evacuation procedures, and they evacuated the aircraft on water.
Yeah.
Okay. So now, tell me something now. What do you mean by evacuation?
Evacuation is a process of getting the passengers out at emergency situation. At emergency situation.
Okay. In an emergency situation, how do you take steps make the passengers leave?
Passengers out of the aircraft. Yes.
Okay. What is pilot incapacitation?
Pilot incapacitation is pilot or co-pilot losses his physical or mental abilities inside the cockpit. It can be subtle, which is partial loss, and another one will be obvious, the total loss of the control of the pilot.
Okay, and why is restraining, restraint is used to restrain any passenger? Why is it done? Why do we restrain the passenger?
For example, unruly passengers. If they do not obey the cabin crew instructions or the flight instructions.
Oh, good. Then, what happened? Now, tell me, what is decompression?
Decompression is leakage of air inside the cabin crew from outside. It can be either loss of air in the cabin crew or
loss of cabin pressure.
Loss of cabin pressure, or else a large structural damage inside the
That is the decompression is the loss of cabin pressure. It happens because if there is any structural damage to the aircraft or a leakage of the aircraft.
Leakage.
So there are two types of decompression: slow decompression and rapid decompression.
Slow is the leakage of air inside the from the aircraft, and rapid is large structural damage.
Okay.
So it can't able to control it.
What do you mean by turbulence?
It's a irregular motion of aircraft because of atmospheric pressure outside the aircraft in the air.
Irregular motion of the aircraft.
Irregular motion of the aircraft because of atmospheric pressure outside the aircraft.
No, because of the weather disturbance, because of the weather problems. It's no pressure related thing. Okay. Then, how many types of turbulence do we have?
Anticipated, unanticipated. Anticipated is light, moderate, and severe. Unanticipated is clear of air turbulence.
Very good, very good. Clear air turbulence. Very good. And okay, so I believe that you have understood, and even the video which I was shown, you have got an idea how the cabin crew take steps in case any emergency arises, be it fire, be it decompression, be it restraining of the passenger, anything. Okay. Now, as you can see right here on the screen, it says wide body aircraft and narrow body aircraft. Now, there are two types of aircraft, I would say, like the classification, you can say. So there can be a wide body aircraft which has more than one aisle, and there can be no narrow body aircraft which can have only one aisle. Now remember, I have told you what is aisle in the aircraft. Aisle is the part among
among this between the seats,
between the row of seats. So that is, it's kind of a pathway, so it's a way from where the cabin crew moves passenger. So narrow body aircraft has one aisle, and wide body aircraft has more than one aisle. It can be two, it can be three also.
Okay.
Now that depends on the how the aircraft design, design of the aircraft.
Yes, okay.
Now, as you can see in the picture, in the narrow body aircraft, you see there are six seats abreast.
Yeah.
If you can count, do you see my cursor moving?
Yes. You can see.
So just look at here. One, two, three. Three seats here.
Yeah.
And then there is this aisle.
Yeah.
Then opposite again in front of that, one, two, three seats. So total six seats abreast, facing the front of the aircraft. So this is what you will be able to see in the narrow body aircraft. This will be in the economy, but in the business or the first class, it will be four seats abreast. See, one, two, and then
okay.
This is how it is in the narrow body, and in the wide body aircraft, it can be obviously it is more than six seats abreast. It can be seven, it can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, it can be 10, it can be in between, depending on the design of the aircraft, how it is being built. And also in the business class, it can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 with two aisles, so six seats abreast, depending. And even in the first class, it can be three seats abreast. So depending on the structure of the how it is being built. Okay. Now let's move ahead. The aircraft which we fly, like we normal passengers fly, cabin crew, we do job, we carry our work on the aircraft, that is used for commercial purpose. And that's the reason we call them as a, they are commercial aircraft, because they take the passengers from one destination to other. They are doing business, they're making revenue, they're retaining passengers, and they are making money out of it. So it's all for commercial purpose.
Commercial purpose.
Okay? Yes, exactly. So commercial aircraft manufacturers. So what are these commercial aircraft manufacturers? There are two commercial aircraft manufacturers when we talk about, and they are Airbus and Boeing. So what is an Airbus? There's a type. These are the type of commercial aircrafts. So first is Airbus. Airbus, it was founded in 1970. Okay, somewhere around 1970. And the headquarters is in Leiden, Netherlands.
Okay.
Well, it's a consortium of the European countries, and there are many European countries which are associated with, the Airbus.
Airbus, okay.
Yes. There is France, there is Belgium, there is Germany. So there are, I think, 4 to 5 European countries or something like that. So, okay. But the headquarters is in Netherlands.
Netherlands, okay.
Okay. Now, when we talk about the second commercial aircraft, which is Boeing, it was founded in 1917. Okay, it's an American aircraft manufacturing company, and the headquarters is in Chicago, Illinois, United States.
Okay.
So don't forget this. Just remember this basic information. Okay.
Ma'am,
so let's move ahead.
Can you switch on to previous page? I have to take the screenshot.
Screenshot of the previous one?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Just a second.
That wide body and narrow body, I think. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Okay. So now you see these this picture of different Airbus aircraft types.
Okay.
Do you see these?
Yeah, yeah, yes.
See, first is Airbus A300, then Airbus A310, then Airbus A320 family. I'm going to tell you all about these. Then Airbus A330, Airbus A340, Airbus A350, Airbus A380, A380, and the last is Airbus A220. So now, normally, these are all the aircrafts on which the cabin crew are trained, and they are trained on depending on the type of aircraft which that particular airline has. Okay, for example, if we talk about the airlines in India, then normally they have 320 aircraft or Boeing. Okay, for example, if you talk about Indigo or say SpiceJet or Vistara or even Air India, they all have this Airbus 320 most of the time, mostly these Indigo Airlines and Vistara. However, they do have big aircraft as well. Not Indigo. Indigo has not yet taken any big aircraft. I haven't heard the news yet. Okay. But Air India has every type of aircraft. They have Boeing, they have Airbus, they have narrow body aircraft, they have wide body aircraft, they have all types of aircraft. And because Air India flies all around the world, including India, that's the reason why they have the narrow body as well as the wide body. So, one, you see that here it is mentioned Airbus A320 family. Mm. Airbus A320 family is, there are different types of A320 and that is included in that family. Like for example, Airbus A319, Airbus A321 and Airbus A320. And so these kind of types of Airbus aircraft which are included in that family comes into the Airbus 320 family. Now, Airbus A300 family also comes into that, 310, 320, 330, 340, like that. Okay? So, you will be trained once you get hired in any airline, you'll be trained on that particular aircraft, which airline flies. Now, we talk about the Boeing aircraft types. As you can see, there are different Boeing aircraft. Boeing 707, 717, 727, 737, 747, and so on. So, because as Airbus A380 is one of the aircraft in the Airbus type, which is double decker, exactly the same way here in the Boeing, one of the type of the Boeing also has the double decker. So these aircraft are used for a long route and they carry lots of passengers.
Double bed means inside there will be stairs, right?
Double decker.
Yeah, double decker. First floor, second floor, it will be like.
Yes, yes. Okay. First floor, second floor.
Yes, okay. Okay.
And obviously, they have lots of crew.
Okay.
No. Okay. Till now, you have understood everything? Any questions?
No, not yet.
Okay. Okay, let me ask you, as I've already told you that today there will be, I'll be asking you questions related to many things. Okay. So, be ready. Tell me, what is the body of an aircraft called as?
Fuselage.
Fuselage, okay. Very good. What is the tail section of the aircraft called as?
Empennage.
Empennage. What are the primary controls of an aircraft?
Aileron, elevator and rudder.
Give me the function of the elevator.
Elevator is used for pitching control of the aircraft for nose up and nose down, for takeoff and landing.
Nose up and nose down.
Yeah.
Okay. And what is the function of the ailerons?
Ailerons are used for the rolling control of the aircraft.
Where the rudder is situated, located?
It is in vertical stabilizer of the trailing part of the aircraft.
Okay, good. Where do we find spoilers and what are they?
Spoilers are in the leading edge of the wings, and they are used for brakes. They are used as brakes of the aircraft.
They act as brakes.
Yeah.
Where is the leading edge of the wing? Do you see the spoiler?
Leading edge, the flaps will be after flaps. The spoilers will be
situated. Like in the middle. In the middle.
Yeah, in the middle. Yes, in the middle.
Where are the slats located?
Slats are in the leading edge.
First. And then where are the flaps located?
Flaps are in the trailing edge, like at the inner part of the wing.
Okay. And where is
in
aileron?
The inner part of the wing. Aileron is at the outer part of the wing. Like a back
shape.
Okay.
Good. How many navigational lights do we have on aircraft?
5 navigational lights.
Name all of them.
In the wings, 2. At the belly, 1. And landing gear, 1. And at the trailing edge, 1. B.
I'm talking about the navigation lights. You said 5, right?
5, yeah. Right.
Are you sure there are 5 navigation lights?
Oh, I think only.
So that's why I'm telling you, name all of them and tell me where are they. It doesn't matter, even if you have forgotten, it's okay. I can show you the picture, that's fine. But then try to remember. At least give me the 2.
One is in landing gear. It's a navigational light. It's in landing gear. And another one is in nose. Like at the upper part of the fuselage.
Did you take the screenshot of the navigation lights?
No, I didn't take it.
Now do you remember? See, there are wings, 2 wings, red on the left side and green on the right side, which is the starboard side. So there are 2 there. And then the strobe lights next to the red and green, that makes them 4. Then there is another white light on the tail above the exhaust and on the wing tips. So 5.
Okay.
You were right in the number, but you couldn't tell me where were. And why are they used? They give the direction and the dimension of the aircraft. Now, I'll show you the picture once again. It's okay, I'll show you the picture once again so that you can remember. Okay?
Yes, ma'am.
And this is the anti-collision light, top and the bottom. Always remember,
yes,
anti-collision is always on the top of the aircraft and the belly of the aircraft, the bottom, okay, which are often called as rotating beacons.
Okay. rotating beacons.
Yes, and these are.
So the, in landing gear, there will be.
Nose landing gear? You were talking about the nose landing gear? Okay. There is, yes, there is, but that is used for the landing purpose.
Landing purpose, okay.
Yes.
I got confused with that one navigational aid.
See, because in flight, the gears are up inside. They right? When they will go down during the night, there will be the lights on the landing gears as well as on the nose.
Okay.
White lights, right? Remember?
Yeah. And 1 second.
Yes.
Okay.
What is an aerofoil?
It's a It is a shape of a wing, through which the air flows. Through which the air flows. To make the aircraft take off. It is a shape of a wing, which is designed in aerofoil shape to. Used for takeoff of the aircraft.
Yeah, it generates lift also.
Yes, it is used for lift purpose.
But then aerofoil is the structure in the wing which actually helps it to, with the formula of that air flying above, it has the low pressure, and the air flying down, at the bottom with high pressure, will generate the lift.
Yeah,
and
bottom with high pressure and the upper with low pressure, so that exactly. It will hit the ground surface and make the aircraft fly.
What are the forces which act on the aircraft? The four forces.
Lift, weight, drag, and thrust. Lift is proportional to weight, and thrust is proportional to drag.
Lift, weight, drag, and.
Drag and thrust.
Can you please give me the meaning of a terminal building?
Terminal building is a building in which the operations of the air, operations of the every operations of the aircraft has been carried out. Terminal building in which, for example, taking like ticketing and migration process and
migration. What is migration? Immigration.
Immigration. Sorry. Yeah. Sorry.
Yes. Immigration. There is a difference between migration and immigration.
Yes.
Okay. Now, okay. Could you please tell me? If it is
twenty thirty hours,
could you please tell me the time in 12-hour clock?
8:30.
Good. 13:45.
1:45.
1:45 what? Which time of the day? What time? Or what half of the day? Or what part of the day? Is it in the afternoon or evening or morning?
It's in midnight. Midnight 1:45.
Are you sure it's in midnight 13:45?
Yeah, I'm sure.
It's
Like if
1:45.
it's afternoon means in 24 hours clock, it will show as 1:45. If it is in night means after 12 o'clock, it will be given as 13, 14, 15, right?
And that is after midnight, 13, 14, 15.
Okay.
Okay, you know what? This is your homework for tomorrow. I need you to study very closely the 24 hour clock and the 12 hour clock. And I will ask you each and every time what time is it of the day, because this is what you need to know, because you can't keep on making mistakes and all these things. Because I will have discussed this further. And I just want to know, because see, it's clearly written here, 24 hour clock, midnight to midnight, from 0 to 24. So you understand that if it is 13:45 in the midnight, then how come after 0 it again straight away goes to 13? And here it is clearly written 12 hour clock, midnight to noon. So you have to study this, and I will ask you tomorrow each and every time. And I will throw you questions on that, and I will ask you what this time is in 24 hour clock and what this time is in 12 hour clock. Is that okay?
Okay. Okay.
Practice that, huh?
Okay.
Could you please give me the full form of DGCA?
Director General of Civil Aviation.
Okay, and what is that?
It's used in India for. Through which every through which the each and every instructions of the airport and aircraft have to be taken carried out in India.
It's a regulatory body which checks the registration certificates. What is briefing?
Before
what?
Ask in emergency situation and how to open the emergency exits in case of any emergency situations.
When does what is briefing? See, you were just telling me some things, but when does this happen? And
before takeoff, yes. While after the passengers are inside the aircraft, while the aircraft is started to take off, it's in the runway.
Are you sure about that?
Not in takeoff. After the passengers are all get on board, and after the passengers have been seated. While taxiing, I think so. Well, cabin crew have to give the briefing.
Cabin crew flight day in life happens? How does it happen?
Ma'am?
When we discuss about a cabin crew flight day in life, how does it happen? Tell me from the start.
I have to get up early and reach the airport at the correct time, the aircraft departure time, and have to sign in, and have to attend the briefing.
You said attend the briefing, right?
Yeah, yes, I have to attend the briefing. We have to attend, okay. Cabin crew have to attend the briefing.
So now tell me, what is briefing?
Oh, you asked me this briefing, so I think that. Okay. Briefing means the person will give every instructions about how to carry on in-flight situations for any emergency situations, or else how to handle the fire extinguishers, and the person will ask the questions about that.
Who will ask the question?
Briefing person, ground staff.
What will ground staff do in our briefing? What is ground staff going to do? They will leave the aircraft arrangements and everything. They come to the cabin too. No. See, I'll tell you once again. Okay. Please listen to it very carefully.
Okay.
you have got the roster, you have got the timetable of the flight, which you are supposed to do the next day. You have taken enough rest. You get up, you take shower, you get yourself ready, and wear your uniform and girls for the makeup and everything, and for boys, hair, skin, everything, right? Done. You're shaving and everything done. Then you will reach your transport will come, pick you up, you'll reach the airport, and you will go, you will sign it. Okay? After you have signed in, you will meet the area where all the crew pertaining to that particular flight where you're flying to will gather. Your supervisor, your different other crew members. Okay? Then the briefing will start. Now, what is there in the briefing? In the briefing, the supervisor will ask you questions on SEP, first aid, SEP like safety emergency procedures, what we discussed about emergency and all that, and the different rules which have been out according to the airlines, all these things. Okay? And he's just asking questions just to check your knowledge that you are well, good enough, and your knowledge is up to date, and then they can take you onto the flight. Why? Because in case of any emergency, if anything arises, you are capable of handling that. Okay? Briefing done. And now in the briefing, captain and first officer will also join. They will also give the information about the aircraft, weather, condition, the plan, the route, each and everything, whatever is required. And then you will all head towards the aircraft. You will reach the aircraft. Okay?
Okay.
After you reach the aircraft, you will store your luggage. You will keep your luggage in the designated places. Yes. And after that, you will start carrying out your safety and security check.
Yes, yes.
Okay? Now tell me, what is safety check?
Safety check, it is done before the takeoff of the aircraft. Fire extinguisher, oxygen mask, life vest, first aid kit, medical kit, and the crash axe, and emergency equipment. And after that, jump seat, that overhead bin.
Overhead bin comes into safety check?
The jump seat have to be checked if that is working properly.
Almost correct. Yes. Safety check, you will start doing the checking the safety equipment, the check safety of the safety equipment, and then you will check your jump seat as well.
Yes.
You will check whether the seatbelt folds unsatisfactorily, the quick release harness operates, each and everything about the jump seat and jump the safety seat equipment check. Safety equipment, it definitely will be in your area. Also, you have to check the equipment in the lavatory, because there is a fixed fire extinguisher in the lavatory as well. Okay. After you have done the safety check, you will start doing the security check. Now, what is security check?
Security check is we have to check on the seats, pockets, and we have to for any unidentified object. We have to check on the overhead bin and lavatory and galley.
Very good. Then the boarding starts. We will take our boarding positions. All the crew will take the boarding positions. Ground staff will give the clearance. After getting the clearance, the supervisor will say that the boarding is about to start. Now the boarding will start. Every passenger is on board now. Okay. Now the passenger who is sitting in the overwing exit. There is an overwing exit.
Yes.
Okay. Yes. So with the passengers who are sitting next to the overwing exit, the cabin crew who is responsible for that particular area, they will go to the passenger and they will give an overwing exit briefing.
Briefing.
And what are they briefing on? They are telling the passenger how to open the door, how to operate the door in case of an emergency. And are you willing to do that or not? So there's a dialogue, there's a particular dialogue which you will have to memorize while you are in the training before going online. Okay? So you will remember that and you will give that overwing exit briefing to the passengers.
Okay.
Because in case of an emergency, passengers are sitting next to the evacuator. So they must know how to open the door, and cabin crew will inform about that. Okay. After that, the demonstration will start. You know, we are about to start the demonstration. Kindly, you know, take note of the cabin crew who are doing the demonstration. All this announcement will start, and all the cabin crew will go toward their particular position from where they will start with the demonstration. Like how the seatbelts are fastened, how the oxygen mask come down, how to wear the oxygen mask, how to wear the life jacket, what do you do, and how many signs and signals are there. All these things. You must have seen that, right? Now, we will do the cabin secure. Why do we do the cabin secure?
Cabin secure, for safety of the passengers.
Very good.
We have to ensure the passenger seat belts, and that the tray table and that overhead bin have been closed. The window sheets have to be opened. And extension seat belts have to be given to
very
the passenger
good.
Who are all in need. And baby bassinet have to be removed before while takeoff and landing.
Takeoff, there's no baby bassinet for takeoff. That will be after takeoff. So,
okay.
Baby bassinet, if you're saying about the baby bassinet, then you must say about, you know, in the landing, like before landing. It should be
takeoff. Okay.
So these are the things which we do in the cabin secure. Then, and what about the bulkhead area? Bulkhead area and overwing exit area. What if there are baggages around? What if the passenger have kept the baggage, their laptop bag, their handbag, and the baggage under the seat in the overwing exit or the bulkhead area?
Have to be removed immediately.
Exactly. You tell the passenger that they're going to keep that in the overhead bin.
Yes. Because in an emergency situation, it has to be free to move the passengers.
Exactly. Then after that, the doors will close. This is for the takeoff one I'm talking about. The doors will close and the flight takes off. Okay. Service starts. Service is done. Everything. Now it's time to land. Okay. Mm-hmm. And the aircraft will start to approach towards the destination. And then at that time, we will again do the cabin secure. Now here in this cabin secure, what are we doing? This is the left. Cabin secure before landing. So what are we doing here?
We have to check the passenger seat belts.
Same thing.
Yeah, same thing. If baby bassinet is there, we have to remove it.
Exactly. Very good. Then we land. Then the doors open after the clearance from the ground staff and the permission from the captain. The doors open. Deboarding starts. Passenger boards off. And then when the aircraft is completely empty, the cabin crew will start to do the security check again. And why are we doing the security check again? Tell me.
For searching for any unidentified object.
In case a passenger has forgotten any of these things. And in case if we find any passenger belongings, we have to give it to the ground staff, or we inform the ground staff.
Okay.
Then we also leave the aircraft. The cabin crew also leave the aircraft. We go, we sign out, and the debriefing is done. Why is debriefing done at the end of the
like debriefing is done because I have to admit what all the activities go on inside the aircraft while in flight.
Very good. In case if this is important, we need to discuss. And if there is any feedback, a supervisor has to give to us, then we must.
Okay.
So this was all about a day in the life of a cabin crew. I hope you have got an idea.
Yeah.
Okay. Could you please tell me any 5 benefits of being a cabin crew? Just 5.
Travel allowance, food allowance, accommodation.
Accommodation you don't get every airline, so yes.
Okay.
But this is also one. In case if you get into the Middle East Airlines, yes, you get the accommodation. Then
okay. And
You said hotel. Travel, hotel, accommodation, travel, hotel accommodation, and what else? Visiting different places, traveling around the world.
Yeah.
You're meeting different people, you can say. Anything else?
Yes, we can. We'll be visiting different. We'll be visiting.
What about the salary? What about the salary? Money.
Yes, salary. Yes, good.
Lots of salary, lots of money. Yeah. Right.
Okay.
So all these benefits we get from the cabin crew job. Also, there is one more thing. Like how we do that normal 9-to-5 job, we get the break from 9-to-5 job. We don't need to do that anymore. And we can get as many offs as we have to, for example, like 8 days off in a month, and then
you said off. Okay.
Yes. So there are different benefits also. Okay. Yes. So today, let's start with the first aid. I hope you've understood, or you have ever, you have heard about the first aid. First aid is immediate treatment given to a patient before the medical help arises. For example, if any thing happens, anywhere, wherever you are, maybe at your office or at your home, we are all first aiders. We all are first aiders. We all have that capability. For example, if there's a cut in the finger, what do we do? We take the Dettol and then any antiseptic, liquid, and then apply that. That is also kind of first aid. Or if we have a headache or something, then we go ahead and we take aspirin or any kind of, painkiller. So it's an immediate treatment given to a patient before the medical help arrives. Okay. Now, there are first aid kits which are kept on board the aircraft, and there are different types of first aid kit. So first is the basic first aid kit. Basic first aid kit have all those medicines, like small medicines for stomach pain or diarrhea or nose or anything which have the that small kind of illness or injuries or anything, then we have all the medicines, all the ointments, everything in the basic first aid kit. And basic first aid kits, a crew can open, any crew can open, and there is no permission required from supervisor or the captain.
Okay.
But the only thing is that if there will be a seal on the first aid kit, you have to break the seal, then you open it, and there will be a paper inside it by mentioning all the list of the medicines. Okay? And there will be a column where you have to include the name of the passenger, seat of the passenger, at what time are you giving the medicine, what medicine are you giving, obviously you will select that medicine particular, and then why, what is the history of medical, because there are different columns where you have to mention that why are you giving that medicine to the passenger, the name, the seat number, each and everything. Okay. Then comes the Aero Medical First Aid Kit. Aero Medical First Aid Kit, here crew can open, but with permission. Either permission, obviously, from the captain, because or the permission from the supervisor. Medical practitioner is required here, because there are injections here which we who are not trained to give injections to anyone. And there are different other things like stethoscope as well, and all these things. But some of them, they also can go ahead. But actually, a medical practitioner is required, or a nurse, who actually know how to give injections and all. Then comes the emergency medical first aid. Emergency medical first aid kit is a type of kit where a crew cannot open this kit. Only the medical practitioner can open the kit.
Okay.
And captain's permission is required in this. Okay. And in all, all these things, or somewhere if the medical emergency is, it goes deep where we can't handle ourselves, and a doctor is required or a nurse is required, and in that case we are going to make an announcement.
What I said, in case if there is anyone on board the doctor or any nurse for this
please emergency. Identify yourself to be nearest.
Okay.
It can happen in heart attack kind of emergency, delivery, birth delivery kind of emergency, or any kind of emergency which is very crucial, which is very deep, which we can't handle. So in that case, we'll make an announcement. Now there is a CPR. CPR is a kind of help or an assistance, a medical assistance which is given to the passenger if they have undergone the, you know, they are from the heart attack. They have, if any passenger has got heart attack suddenly, then CPR is used for it. The full form of CPR is cardiopulmonary resuscitation, where we revive the heart. Hello. Okay. So now, as I was talking about the CPR, it's, the full form is cardiopulmonary resuscitation. Here, we give this, you know, medical assistance to the passenger who goes into heart attack. So to revive them back and do not let them go into the biological death, we actually give this CPR. The full form is cardiopulmonary resuscitation. If you want to keep take notes, you may go ahead. Or if you want to take the screenshot, you may go ahead.
I took it.
So here we are reviving the heart and the lungs. It's a procedure done to revive heart and lungs.
Oh, okay. This in that video they show at Friday. You should know.
Yes, yes, exactly. Yeah. That emergency, one of the medical emergencies. Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Yes. Now, it prevents the casualty from going to biological death, as I said. So when it goes to the when anyone approaches towards the biological death, then definitely he's dead completely, declared dead. Now there's a difference between a clinical death and a biological death. Clinical death is something where breathing stops and heart stops beating. Any passenger's breathing will stop and heart will also stop beating. But it's reversible. It can be reversed by giving this CPR.
CPR, okay.
Yes. You know, there is a proper way to give the CPR. Do you see the heel of this wrist? The hand?
Yeah.
You have to keep it right at the, sternum. It's the breastbone. So you just have to keep 1 inch above, 1 centimeter above or something like that. And then you will give this. Because you'll be trained properly on these things. When you will get hired in any of the airlines, you will get a proper first aid training with practical, and you have to pass the practicals also. There will be a dummy like what you have seen in the video. Yeah. The dummy will be there, and you have to start giving the CPR. So you will put the heel of your hand, and you will do like this, and you will start giving the CPR like this. And the location should be the exact, because you do not have to break the obviously the bones. Or the ribs. Okay, so it has to be proper. Then you have to keep giving the breath through the mouth, the blow through the mouth, as you have seen. And also there is one thing during the training, that once you have given the blow, there should be, the chest must rise up and down, otherwise you will fail in the practical. So they are actually checking your breathing capability also, giving the breath capability. So that is also the thing which you will learn while doing the cabin crew training. So that's the clinical death, which can be reversible after you give the CPR. But biological death is brain cells are completely dead and it's reversible. Okay? But you will still have to try, because you don't know. See, we can't, a passenger has just fallen down on the aisle and he has undergone heart attack. How will we know that? We'll start giving the CPR. Because we have no idea what has happened, right? And we have no idea whether he has gone to biological death or he's still in the clinical death. So we don't know. So we'll start giving the CPR and we will try to revive him back to life. Okay? Now this is one of the instruments which is used to give the shock. So that, you know, heart shock. The heart can spring back to life or spring back to start beating. Like AED, the name is AED, automated external defibrillator. And I'm going to ask you all these questions tomorrow.
Okay.
You understand? So take the screenshot. Automated external defibrillator. This is for cardiac arrest, which is heart attack. Okay. And the idea of how it has been, it is used, you have already seen in that video. Okay?
Yeah.
These two, do you see these? These two, yeah, are the pads, the chest pads, which are placed on the respective sites or on a particular location on the chest.
Okay.
And when we apply that, before that, we need to shave the chest. We will shave the chest. There will be no water. We'll pat it dry completely. Then we will start this machine. Whatever the machine tells you to do, you will start doing it accordingly. If obviously this machine will tell you to stand clear. So you will tell, you know, there will be many passengers coming around. If a passenger has fallen down, they will start to go, you know, what has happened, kya hua, and all that. So in that case, what you will do, you will actually go by what has machine said, and the other crew member will actually monitor the area, that the area should be free of any ground. And then you will start this. Okay. Always remember that. And then you'll start giving the shock accordingly, it says. Now, after using this machine, even if the passenger has not come back to life, then we are not the one to declare that. We will keep giving CPR until we land. Till we land.
Okay. Okay.
This is what we are being trained.
Till we land.
Yeah, I mean, the flight lands, because we are in the flight, right? This has happened in the flight. So this will keep on, we will keep on doing with the CPR thing. And meanwhile, when this has happened, the first thing the cabin crew will do is will make the announcement, because this is a heart attack. The cabin crew are not, fully capable of handling it, right? So we will make the announcement, ladies and gentlemen. If there is any medical practitioner or nurse on board, please identify yourself to the nearest cabin member, right? So in case if there is a doctor, then definitely they will do an approach. And if they declare death after using all these things, then definitely that passenger is dead. And then we will hand it over to the ground staff or the family, obviously, at the arrivals. Okay. And I have seen a few heart attack cases during my flight.
Okay.
It has happened. But some were alive, most of them were dead. Mm-hmm. So it happens. This is how you give the shock. Almost this is the effect which is there on the heart, which happens on the heart when you give the healing. It starts to revive, and then it starts to throw the blood, and then it starts flowing. Like how in biology you must have learned that how heart works, the circulatory system works, right?
Yeah.
So it's a, like string like movement. Then there is birth on board. Are you understanding all these things? In case if you're not, please ask me.
Yeah, sure.
Birth on board. In case of any medical emergency, baby can be delivered on board the aircraft. And the cabin crew are well trained on the process.
Okay.
They're well trained in the process means they have been shown video, they have been, in their manual, in the cabin crew manual, they are being told that these are the stages, how you're going to deliver the baby. And there is a separate kit, a universal kit, where you have all the things which is related to take the, for the delivery of the baby. So these are the things. And the delivery obviously will happen in the galley. You have to clear the galley, you have to prepare the galley for the baby delivery.
Galley?
Yes, galley. Okay. You have to secure the galley, and that, because that is only one area in the flight in case if the mother will start experiencing or the labor pain, then you have to take her back to the galley and all the crew. Obviously, there will be crew and they will start helping for the birth on board. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, any questions? Any questions?
not at all. Oh, galley, toilet, right? Galley means toilet.
No, galley is the kitchen. Remember I showed you that day? Galley is the kitchen. Let me show you again.
Oh, so lavatory is toilet.
Lavatory. Yes, lavatory is the toilet. This is the bed.
Okay.
This is the bed. I haven't shown you the lavatory, right? Just a second. I should show you the lavatory. Wait.
Screen is not visible.
I'll share the screen.
Okay.
Okay, I'm sharing the screen. It was here. And I will show you the I was showing you the door. So it was right there of the door. This one. Okay, let me share the video. Oh, sorry, let me share. No, can you see the screen?
Yeah, miss.
Now, do you see the cursor moving?
Oh, yeah.
Do you see this right above the interphone? Do you see this? This is known as attendant indication panel. Okay. This is located at each and every cabin crew station where what happens is whenever any passenger presses from the cabin, within from the lavatory, there is a message which comes right here on the fluorescent area, and it says that passenger call this seat, passenger call this seat, or passenger call from lavatory D or A or E, depending. Okay. And if there is a normal call, if it is a normal call, like passenger call is a normal call, so in that case, there is a green light here that will come on. So any kind of normal call, be a flight deck calling to cabin crew a normal, or a cabin crew calling flight deck normal, there will be a green light with the message here.
Okay.
Okay. The green light will come on. Now, in case if it is an emergency call, now what can be an emergency call? Emergency call can be obviously from the flight deck. It can be an emergency call. It can be an emergency call from the lavatory. If there is any smoke in the lavatory, then the lavatory smoke detector will come on, and you know, the light will come on. So in that case, there is a red light here. The red light will start to flash, or red light will come on with the message here. Got it?
In case of any emergency situation.
In case of any emergency.
The red light.
The mess. Yes, the message will come. That is for sure. But the light differs. Light will come on. Red light will come on in case of an emergency. And
emergency,
green light.
It's a normal call.
Exactly. Normal cases. Okay. And I hope you have also understood about the cabin pressure light and the warning light, which I have discussed. So, these two, right? Slide down warning light is the light when you are trying to open the door and the slide down warning light comes on. That shows that the slide is not properly disarmed. So you will store the handle back and will again do the process, and then you will start opening the door. In case if the cabin pressure warning light starts to flash red, that means there is a pressure trapped in the cabin and it's not free. And that's why we have to inform the commander, and he will do all the necessary steps to, you know, relieve the cabin of the pressure. Okay? Okay. Okay, one thing I need to ask, tell you. Be punctual.
Okay.
I know you try to be punctual, but there can be the internet issues, but be punctual. And also from tomorrow, I will start the interview skills. And in interview skills, if you have any questions, see, tomorrow I will ask what I've taught you. But in interview skills, if you have any questions regarding any kind of questions, then please let me know, because we will discuss. I will discuss thoroughly about it. Like in case if you have applied to an aviation job, and these are the questions you think that you will be asked, write it down and ask me so that we can discuss.
Okay.
I hope you have enjoyed the session. Yeah. And okay, thank you so much for attending, and I'll meet you tomorrow.
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Yes.
See you.
Thank you.
Take care.
Bye. Take care. Bye.